Speculation, rumors running absolutely rampant. And Chris, there's no way you can't tell me this doesn't affect the team member. All-American wideout Charles Rogers, one of Smoker's best buddies.
And we will get into that story as the day rolls on. Boy, Jason Daly getting into that. And Michigan will take over from its own 20. John Navarre making his 25th career start. He did not have a touchdown pass last week against Iowa, one of only three times that's happened in his career. Braylon Edwards has been Navarre's favorite target, leading the team with 41 catches.
Yeah, Benny Joffre's a big tight end that can stretch the field. Good player, great hands.
Always an asset to have those tight ends. As Michigan told us, they would like to get that running game established early. Michigan State has had trouble stopping it. And right away, they go to B.J. Askew, and Askew, who is starting in place of Chris Perry, is stopped in his tracks. Take a look at the big guys up front now for Michigan. Tony Pape is Michigan's biggest and best offensive lineman. He has been flopped over from the right tackle to the left tackle position. And for Michigan, the Spartans' young defensive line has gotten even younger. There's a shakeup on their D-line because Greg Taplin, their junior defensive end, has been suspended for this game for violating a training rule. So he is out of the lineup. That was a three-yard game last play, Chris.
They need to play big defensive line. They need to get those linebackers free so they can make some plays.
And Askew, who has been the starting fullback for this Michigan team, picks up four. Kevin Vickerson stops him. The Spartans have also reshuffled their linebackers. Redshirt freshman Seth Mitchell starting in the middle for the second straight game. Thomas Wright, the leader of this defense, leading tackler. He also has three interceptions.
See right there, B.J. Askew playing for Chris Perry on that injured ankle. They like to get him established inside. He's a powerful inside runner. He's not much of a threat going outside, but inside, he can hit it up in there.
More of a tailback kind of guy than a fullback anyway. Navarre up top for the first time. Braylon Edwards bobbles and drops it all by himself, and he was unable to bring it in, so Michigan has to punt.
That's a big series for Michigan State to get a three and out the first series. It gives them an opportunity. You'll see right here, Braylon Edwards runs what they call an option route, takes him in and breaks it out. Henry loses sight of him. All you got to do is catch the ball. That's a nice pass by Navarre. Bring it in, Braylon.
And that's an example, obviously, of a... It'll go down as an incompletion, but it was all Edwards' fault. Adam Finley in to punt for the first time. Zeal Kavanaugh, run it up. There's the halo rule flag as Kavanaugh is driven backwards. Only a 36-yard punt, and for now at least a 1-yard return, but that will be a halo rule violation.
Again, a great decision by Kavanaugh to go ahead and field the punt, knowing that if he drops it, he had a halo violation. You give yourself an opportunity to get yards off the penalty, or you can return it.
Illegal interference, 2-yard radius foul on the kicking team, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, first down.
And that's exactly what happened. Dave Whitvogt leading our Big Ten officiating crew. For the second week in a row, sophomore Damon Dowdell starts for Jeff Smoker. He did, however, sprain an ankle late in last week's loss to Wisconsin. We'll keep an eye on that. Already told you about Charles Rogers, and they're going to have to get some running game going here,
yeah,
too.
Juwan Moss and B.J. Lovett needs to be a factor. He'll make Rogers better.
Juwan Moss, relatively strong game last week. This running game has been rather stagnant all season, and we see Moss on the very first carry, and he might have lost a half a yard. Jeremy Lasur, the cornerback, coming up to make the stop. The Spartan offensive line, while their leader is Brian Otney, the center, though, was benched for a portion of last week's game after he committed his third major penalty in 3 weeks. The Wolverines have sacked opposing quarterbacks 27 times. Senior Dan Rumashek leads the way. He has four. And on that first play, they're going to officially say it was no gain. So second and 10, there's Rogers, number one, in motion. Dowdell looking for his tight end Knott, and Eric Knott, who's 6'3", not quite tall enough to bring it in. Taking a look now at the Michigan linebackers, Diggs, Kaufman, and Victor Hobson.
Yeah, Victor Hobson's are all Big Ten All-American candidate. Very active, plays on the weak side, runs around and makes a lot of plays.
He is their leading tackler, and just a sophomore, Marlon Jackson has a team best three picks from his corner spot. Chris talked about him in the open. We'll see Marlon with the tough task often today of trying to stop Charles Rogers.
You see Marlon right there. He's matched up with Rogers right here in this third down situation.
And it is third and 10, exactly what Michigan State did not want. Dowdell, then as he throws, and he finds Rogers for the first down.
Yeah, you see Marlon Jackson right now. He's down there talking to safety, saying, hey, I'm in cover two. I'm going to jam him at the line of scrimmage. If he takes up off the field, I'm going to pass him off to the safety. See, Marlon does a good job of pushing him outside. Now, safety has got to come over here. He's late breaking down the ball. Marlon has threats in the flat. He can't go get him. And Damon, that's good for Damon McDowell because he said, I want to start fast. He delivers a nice ball to his number one guy, Charles Rogers.
You see the season numbers on him. Again, this is his second straight start. That was a 26-yard gain on third and 10. Moss, nowhere to go. The maize and blue, Jeremy Lasorda again coming up with his second tackle. Carl Diggs in as well.
DeJuan Moss is not an outside threat. You don't want to stretch the field with DeJuan Moss. He's an inside pounder. He's not an outside nice runner. He's an inside pounder where he wants to put a helmet on somebody.
And he is a guy, Chris, who was a fullback until this season, and the tailback switch has not been an easy one for him.
But he knows what he is, but when you try to run him outside, that's what he's not. He's an inside guy. Run him inside.
Second and 12, he lost to. There's not unable to gather that short pass in, so another third and long coming up for the Spartans.
That's one Eric Knott, big tight end, athletic tight end, who actually Michigan defensive staff is worried about. He's got to bring that in. He's got to get a chance to make a play, make a play.
He has been their leading receiver in three games this season, and not only a sophomore. They do expect great things from him.
He saw about 12 blue jerseys coming out. There are only 11, but he saw 12 coming at him.
Five defensive backs now in.
Yeah, Michigan State's 34% third downs, Pam. Conversion.
They got not over the middle, but not nearly enough for the first down as he is eventually taken down by John Shaw.
Yeah, but it's a good call because they give their kicker a chance at a shorter field goal. They didn't go for it all. Playing a smart, conservative game. Nothing down the field. Go ahead and dump it off to your secondary receiver. Give your kicker an opportunity to punch one in from 39.
Certainly no chance of taking a loss on a sack, so it was a smart play. Jason Daly in to attempt a 39-yard field goal from the wide hash mark. And Daly has given Michigan State the early lead. Make that Dave Rayner with that field goal. So Michigan State gets a big completion on third down and then takes it in for the first score of the game. Dave Rayner getting ready to kick off. Michigan State scoring on his field goal to take a 3-0 lead over Michigan. Rayner now 9 of 11 on the season in field goals. Jeremy Lasorda grabs it at his 3. A lot of real estate in front of him, makes a nice move and is finally dragged down at the 37. Let's make our first visit back to
a little bit more defense. They're not going to hold on to that number one spot. They've been exploited lately.
We had them last week when for three quarters they were played evenly by West Virginia. Nothing doing for Askew. And then he makes something, a little bit of something out of nothing, keeping his legs rolling to pick up a couple.
Again, you see the strength of B.J. Askew. Doesn't have the speed that Chris Perry does, but he is a slasher, inside type runner. Another thing, we were talking to Pro Scout yesterday about BJ. Watching film that BJ does a great job of catching the ball out of the backfield. Great screen pass runner.
And that is vital, obviously, in the NFL. He is actually the third leading receiver on this Michigan team, as well as its second leading rusher. Picked up 3 on that first down carry. Right back to him, and that time maybe a
secure your gap.
Mitchell, just a red shirt freshman on third down. Navar, first down completion to Ronald Bellamy, the senior out of New Orleans.
It's a good read by John Navar that Michigan had trips down to this bottom part of the field. What you want to do then is work away from the trips. John comes back, looks to the trip side, the three wide receiver side. Nothing there. He's going to come over and go right to the single seam side right here. He looked over here, got everybody moving that way, that knows where Bellamy is on a skinny post and delivers the ball low and inside right where you want it, and only where Bellamy could make the catch.
You take a look at Navarre's numbers. Fourth in the Big Ten in passing, making his 25th career start today. Pitching it to Askew, and Askew is met head on. Got South Carolina coming up in a few weeks, 2nd and 9 after that 1-yard play. Navar looking to the left side, and that is incomplete as he was throwing it for his fullback. moved back to the outside. He was a middle backer for much of this year, but has gone back to his natural position and doing better on the outside. Third and nine. Blitz coming. Navarre gets it off. Oh, my goodness. What a catch. Jason Avant. Roderick Nelson was all over him, but Jason got it.
That's a great catch by Avant going across the middle. Always takes courage to go across the middle. And a nice job by Navarre holding the ball long enough to let his receiver get open. You'll see John under pressure, knowing he's going to get hit. Avant going up and making the catch with his hands. Nice job with his hands. Actually, pretty decent coverage right there by Michigan State. And Roderick Nelson had a nice break on the ball. Just Avant did a good job of using the hands, screening him off with his body.
How about that, Chris, too? It's Avant's first collegiate career catch, and it's a memorable one. Navarre, plenty of time to find his receiver, Jermaine Gonzalez. Another Michigan first down. Coming up. That last play was a 21-yard gain. Michigan now down on the 11. Askew running over a couple of folks. Takes it in close to the 3. A 7-yard gain for Askew.
That was what they called the power hole week. Will they get the backside guard away from the tight end? Pulling around with Sanderson, the fullback, leading the hole. What you have is two lead blockers. What I like about John Navarre, when he's throwing the ball, he's throwing strikes so far. He's been under some criticism. Quick count, quick count.
Askew, not much that time.
See, I had a flashback there. I started yelling, quick count, quick count. Because what happens is the offensive line, when you see those big hogs up there and they start running the line of scrimmage and getting a three-point stance, and everybody hurrying, they try to catch Michigan State's defense off guard. But Michigan State was ready and met the challenge for the quick count on a short yardage goal line play.
Third and three now. You see Michigan inside the 20. They've scored 18 touchdowns and 32 trips.
That's not good. 22 of 32 is not good in the red zone.
Two tight ends in for Michigan. They can make a first down without scoring a touchdown. Askew gets close to the first down marker near the 1-yard line.
It's a decision time now. This game is billed as the backyard brawl. Now, what do you do if you're Lloyd Carr? Do you want to see if your boys are ready for the backyard brawl after they got punched in the face by Iowa and didn't respond last week? They want to go for it. Lloyd, this is your call, buddy. Find out what kind of team you have. I say go for it.
Fans obviously yelling for Carr to go for it.
Yeah, if you didn't get the first down.
And they will measure.
Well, you got to go for it. You got a chance to get a first down. Ooh. Oh, short.
Just the little chain link short. And Navarre staying out there.
Oh, yeah.
Michigan 5 of 10 on fourth down conversion so far this season.
No question, you go for it. This is where you're going to find out about your football team right here. How are we going to respond after getting embarrassed in the big house last week?
And some of those Iowa players, when they left, said that they were tougher than Michigan.
Yeah, well, you know, Michigan has a chance to show their toughness now. Now, if you're Michigan State, you got to penetrate. You know who's getting the ball. Look for the sneak. Got a 6'6 quarterback.
But they go to Askew, and he plunges into the end zone. Touchdown, Wolverines.
I'll tell you what, they were tough there because they opened up a big hole and their pad level was great and they drove Michigan State off the ball. They answered the challenge. They answered Lloyd Carr's challenge. Say, boys, I believe in you. Let's knock it in.
Adam Finley, the third place kicker that Michigan has used this year, knocks home the extra point. So Michigan, responding after that loss to Iowa, goes for it on fourth down, and B.J. Askew scores his second rushing touchdown of the season. How about Askew coming in and 2-yard touchdown run as Michigan converted 2 third downs and 1 fourth down on a drive that ate up 6 minutes and 43 seconds. Spartans, Jaron Hayes takes it out from his own end zone, slips a tackle, and he is taken out around the 31-yard line by the kicker for the Braves. He's tough, so is Matt Wong. kickers. We just went to break with Philip Grabs making a nice tackle. He's a kicker who will make special teams tackles, and kickers in that Northwestern Indiana game not doing it, Chris.
You got to make the extra points. Those are gimmies.
David Richard now is the tailback as Dowdell, who can run, decides to pass. It's tipped up in the air and falls to the grass, but it could have been big trouble. Marlon Jackson is right in Eric Knott's face.
Yeah, that's where Damon Dowdell has to think about running the football. You know he's limited by ankle, but he tries to force it into Eric Knott. Then Jackson puts him in the hurt locker and threw away the key. You get hit. That's not good to get put in a hurt locker. Man, that was a nice hit for a corner at that.
How do you get out of the hurt locker?
You got to put somebody back in the hurt locker to take your place.
It's a replacement. Yes. Well, you talked about Jackson in the open, Chris, and he's made a couple of big plays already.
He's a big time player. The best corner, best cover guy.
A big time hit. Richard picking up a couple. He is a true freshman from St. Louis. Marlon Jackson is a guy, when you're in the same category as Charles Woodson, you got to be pretty good.
Yeah, and you know, the thing I like about him, Pam, is his size. He's a corner. He's a physical corner. You saw him jam Charles Rogers in the coverage, which he did his job. Then you saw him read the bootleg, come out of his coverage, and hit Eric Knott on a crossing route. And not knocked out. He's a good player, big time prospect.
And yeah, just a sophomore, one pass breakup away from tying Charles Woodson's single season record at Michigan. That time the pass is complete to Knott. A lot of underneath stuff, and that's not nearly enough. On third down, they got to punt it. Jackson again on the coverage.
See, Knott's got to be able to either get some kind of forward progress or try to make a move to miss Jackson. Miss that time he did not. And Jackson again, a sure tackle. See, he came up, he wrapped his arms, he brought his feet, and brought the big man down.
Jason Daly in the punt. Charles Rogers has caught just the one pass so far today as he's being covered, and Knott has become the favorite receiver so far. That drive stalls. Marcus Curry is back to receive Jason Daly's punt, has to come up for it. Fields it at the 28, and on the dead run is tackled down at the 40. And now John the Barn Company taking over from the 40. Sanderson, the big fullback, was in motion, but going to Benny Joffre, the first time that we have seen their talented tight end. Thank you, Matt. So Duke trying to pull off the upset against Clemson. And Rutgers, obviously, that would be monumental. Askew keeping it going and lunging forward. Should be a first down. Ronald Stanley with the stop, but Askew just kept going forward.
Yeah, he's a powerful guy inside. Now, that was a counter OF. And what that is that means that the back is the second puller and the offensive lineman is the first puller, as opposed to what we call the power, where the back is the first lead blocker and the offensive lineman is the second puller. Just a little football 101 in a running game.
How about Chris Perry now coming in for the running game for Michigan? First time we've seen him. That was a first down run. Perry, a little ankle injury, blocks on that play as Ronald Bellamy gets a couple of yards after catch, picking up 8. It'll be second and 2 coming up. Pam Ward, Chris Spielman, and Rob Stone joining you from the Big House in Ann Arbor, Michigan. The 13th-ranked Michigan Wolverines trying to rebound from a loss here last week to Iowa, playing Michigan State. And after a loss under Lloyd Carr, Michigan has responded very nicely indeed at 15-4. Just two losses on the season, Iowa and Notre Dame, and that's considered to be kind of a downer this deep into the season. Big expectations.
High standard of Michigan.
Perry, big hole. First down as he gets it down to the 35-yard line. That's a 5-yard gain for Perry.
You know, one of the things coming into this game, talking to Lloyd Carr yesterday, is that they've been disappointed in how they've run the football. They were going to establish a run today no matter what. I don't care who's running the ball. They're going to establish the run. There's Chris Perry. As you can see, he's a good inside runner, big kid. A little more speed than B.J. Askew. Breaking tackles, not one guy can get you. It takes two to get me. Tough player.
He's a junior. Oh, that is a tip up. Perry, great job tipping it to himself. He's going to lose a yard, but they're lucky they didn't lose the football.
Yeah, you're right. He's got to secure the pitch, but I'll tell you what, he showed a lot of moxie. because he knew he was going to get hit, and you're up there tipping the ball around to yourself, knowing you got big 300-pounders bearing down on you. He does a good job of at least securing the football. That's a nice job of keeping that ball in play. Look, five guys come to him. One thing about Michigan State, too, they're playing hard. They're playing hard. They're running to the football.
That has been one of the criticisms that we have heard here. Some people claiming that Michigan State has quit. Losers of five of their last six. They're showing none of that, obviously, today. Navarre, pass complete to Braylon Edwards. That's going to be a face mask on the...
Put your face mask on his face mask. That way you don't have to worry about grabbing a face mask. Braylon Edwards has a little shake there, too.
Third and run. Personal foul. Face mask. Defense. 15 yards from the end of the run. Automatic first down.
That's a killer. That's a killer. See Mitchell right here now. See, put your face mask in. Let go. If you grab it, let go. Don't jerk him around.
That is huge. That 15-yard penalty puts the ball on the 16. And last week in that loss to Wisconsin, Michigan State had a personal foul on the opening kickoff, a grand total of 10 penalties for 96 yards. It has really hurt them this season. First down for the Wolverines. Askew back in the game. Showing the power, he is finally dragged down by the shoulders by Thomas Wright, the talented strong safety for the Spartans.
Now Thomas does a good job on his run field, but you got to bring a little more neck roll with you, Thomas, when you're tackling BJ Askew. You got to come in and bring your feet. Now BJ delivered a blow. When a guy has the ball, he's the running back, he's the hittee, the defender's a hitter. That time BJ became the hitter and the defender became the hittee.
That was nine yards on that carry, and Wright has had double figure tackles six of his last seven games. Askew breaking tackles, nose for the end zone, and he is stopped down on the 1 yard line, but that will be another Wolverine first down.
That's in the tempo. See, they're coming out, they know that they have Michigan State backpedaling right now. They're coming out and they're getting a quick snap. You'll see right here. Now BJ Askew, bam, missed tackle. Thomas Wright came with a little more neck roll, throwing BJ Askew back, but there were four missed tackles on that play. If you want to be a good run stopping team, you better wrap him up, because he's not going to go down with arm tackles.
That was a good job by Wright to wrap him up, but it was not until Michigan had picked up a first down. They're sitting inside the 1 yard line as we head towards the 1 minute mark here in the first half.
Yeah, they got to respot the ball. It looks like the ball's in the end zone. Move it back, guys. Give them a chance. There you go. They had the ball on the line. You can't put the ball on the line.
Dave Pearson is the center, a junior from Brighton, Michigan.
Brighton. He's bright. When he took the ball, moved it up to the goal line.
They move it back, scooch it back a couple inches, and Navarre snakes it at himself for another Wolverines touchdown. Michigan wanted to get that running game established, and they have done so here in the first quarter.
Now, when you're 6'6 and you got about 2 inches to go, smart play. A lot of times quarterbacks will take that on their own, called off an audible. He went to the south part of the defensive line and just reached the ball over.
Finward makes it 14-3. Michigan scoring touchdowns on its last two possessions. Let's go down to Rob Stone.
Well, Pam, I think we all expected a lot of coach speak and cliches for the Michigan State coaching staff in our conference call this week, but defensive coordinator Bill Miller, man, he let it fly. A couple beauties that he floated out to us. Whole roof has caved in on this team. We were inept versus the run last week, and he admitted to us that some of his players took some plays off in the last game. Chris, you hear this from a respected coach. What goes through your mind?
Well, if you got players taking plays off, then you know what? Make them take a whole bunch of plays off. Find kids. I don't care if they're walk-ons. You have to get them out of the science building. It doesn't matter. Bring kids in there, put a green helmet on them, and tell them go 100 miles per hour. You can't have guys taking plays off. And Bill Miller's a fine defensive coach. I've known him for a while. He'll get these kids playing hard. And today, we're getting beat up a little bit now, but at least from my perspective up here in the box, they are still playing hard and they're running to the ball.
Bill Miller in his fourth year as the defensive coordinator at Michigan State. And one of the points brought up was there was so much hype on this team, a preseason top 25, as Brabs kicks it off. Perhaps, especially defensively, maybe the talent wasn't there. Kyle Brown brings it out from 2 yards deep and should not have. Gets up to around the 18-yard line where the Spartans will.
Gators, a good game.
And they finish up with Georgia Tech. Boy, nothing doing there as Moss goes down quickly. Let's go to Matt. Thank you. That would be huge for Northwestern. Still looking for its first win in Big Ten play. Jason Wright, a very talented all-around player for them.
Yeah, converted wide receiver. Move back to running back.
And they also get Brett Bazinet, their starting quarterback, back. He's been out for 2 weeks with a broken leg.
You know, one thing, too, about this game here and this Michigan team, they've really come out fired up. Not only the coaches and the players, but usually the Big House is sometimes known as a kind of a, the quietest 100,000-plus people at a game that you'll ever hear. But today, they're fired up, ready to go. They don't want to make the mistake of letting their team down, maybe like they did last week, being too quiet against Iowa.
Michigan State has taken the timeout. Let's take a look at this history. In the 96th time they played, they've been playing for the Paul Bunyan Trophy, the 50th time this year. And that's ever since Michigan State came into the Big Ten. Michigan State, not much success here at Michigan Stadium, but did win last season. A rule change came into effect because of last year's game. John Navarre, late in the fourth quarter, gave Michigan a 24-20 lead. But Jeff Smoker coming back, third and goal. And look at that clock. He's going to spike it. And that 1 second seemed to stay there for a while. And then T.J. Duckett for the win. Michigan State wins at 20. That is the official guy. After the timeout, second and 12 with 7 seconds left in the first quarter. Dowdell time and then throws it to Grass, where there were three blue jerseys around Charles Rogers.
And you're almost trying to force it into Charles Rogers. What they did, they tried to get the matchup. They lined him up at fullback. And during the cadence, he goes out in motion, hoping to create a mismatch in the secondary. But Michigan was prepared for it, adjusted well. Now, Dowdell had B.J. Lovett on a crossing route, but he never looked to him. Rogers was his first option, and that's youth coming out as far as playing, didn't go to his second or third option.
Obviously, a guy making just his second start this year. He did make one last year as well, but thrown into things now with the indefinite suspension of Jeff Smoker, and now he's facing a third and 12. Time again, underneath to Knott. That's been the biggest connection for them so far today. And that's only about a 4-yard gain. So as the first quarter comes to an end, we come back to the second quarter. Michigan State's going to punt it down 14-3. Second quarter about to get underway here in Ann Arbor. Michigan State has just completed its second straight three and out. Michigan has scored on two straight drives, up 14-3. And we see Jason Daly now, the California kid from San Luis Obispo, in for his second punt. He had a 38-yarder on the first one. Marcus Curry picking up the rolling punt at the 38, his own. And is tackled around midfield. Terrific field position for Michigan when we come back to Ann Arbor. Michigan getting ready to snap the ball from its 49 after another Michigan State punt. Already up 14-3. Askew gets the carry and continues to move his legs forward. He picks up 4 yards. He now has 46 yards on the ground rushing. And this is a Michigan offense that only averaged 131 yards a game. That's their second lowest since 1962. And the rushing yards for Michigan State, not in the good category, -3.
And there's Lloyd Carr. Lloyd told us yesterday in the meeting, he said, look, we're going to run the football. We're going to be a Michigan football team. We will run the ball. There's a huge stat right there. Team leading rush yards has won 32 of the last 33 meetings. Right now, 54-3. Certainly looks good for Michigan.
And growing as Askew gets it up close to another Michigan first down. Ronald Stanley making his sixth tackle. And this Michigan offense run by Terry Malone in his first season as the offensive coordinator, sixth overall with his staff. His new offense, he says when he came in, he wanted to use the two-back offense more, get the running game going, and also distribute the ball to as many different weapons as possible.
Well, he has a quarterback that can do that. Now, Johnson, his second year of starting, he has a better understanding of the offense, and he's been under some criticism, and it's hard to believe. He's had 14 touchdowns and 4 interceptions on the year, and today he's looked outstanding, throwing a couple pinpoint passes where only a good quarterback can make.
about 5 yards short of the first down. But, and you're right, Navarre, the standards are just so high. As take a look at Terry Malone and the rest of his guys up in the booth here. Navarre, 6 of 9 for 67 yards so far today.
Terry right there.
Malone used to be an offensive coordinator at Bowling Green. And he's been at this Michigan staff for the last 6 years, his first year in charge of this offense. And he says he definitely notices a difference in Navarre, more confident. And he's learned to take off and run with the football instead of forcing it, which is huge.
It's a hard habit to break for him. He's a drop-back quarterback out of the Michigan mold. Todd Collins, Elvis Burbach, Tom Brady. Another guy, too, plays for Denver. I don't know his name. Greasy.
That's it. Third and inches, and there's your big guy, Navarre. 6'6", 230. That's like a lot bigger than you, Spiel.
Yeah, he's a big guy. It's a safe call, good call.
For our first score there at Iowa. Meanwhile, Indiana and Northwestern with an entertaining game. This is Perry. Got the carry, and keeping it on the ground. That's the game plan. Picked up a couple on that play.
I want you to look at something here, and if you're Michigan State's defense, here's what to look at. See this guy right here? He's going to take you to the side of the ball every time. He's going to come lead block. There's your lead. Now, there's a third puller coming in. That's like a triple power row. But if you're Michigan State's defense, the fullback in Terry Malone's offense is going to take you to the ball on all running plays. If you go where 44 goes, that's where the ball is going to go when he's in the ball game.
Askew is split out to the left, and that's a huge fullback, too, and Sean Sanderson, number 44, 6'3", 290, not in the game now, is Navarre going up top for Bellamy, makes the catch, touchdown, Michigan. And anybody criticizing Navarre, take a look at that throw, huh, Chris?
Yeah, and you know, Suggs had coverage. Now, what happened was he lost sight, and he lost a sense of purpose of where he was on the football field. He's up there looking in the sky for the ball, but Bellamy's on the sideline. Suggs was in deep coverage. He was deep as the deepest, but he couldn't find the ball or the receiver.
Bellamy scoring his second touchdown of the season through the air as Adam Finley knocks home his third extra point of this game already. Michigan has now scored on three straight possessions. Bellamy's sixth career touchdown on a nice pass by Navarre. All right, Chris, this is a good school, man. How does that work? How do you do that?
I don't know.
An engineering guy probably did that.
That thing's freaking me out.
Must be a Michigan guy. Grabs, kicking it off. Taken right at the end zone line by Jaron Hayes at the goal line. And Hayes trying to get something started as flags fly. We got about three of them down. Brandon Williams made the stop. We'll check out the penalty flags.
Yeah, we got a block in the back. The penalties are killing Michigan State, and you got minus 3 yards rushing. You can't afford to hurt yourself with penalties and give yourself worse field.
Steve Smith and continues to climb. First and 10, David Richard picking up little.
I would agree. And Rutgers played Tennessee, I believe, tough this year, too. So they get up for big games.
And remember, though, Miami came back nicely as Rodgers cannot hold on to the pass. Marlon Jackson blanketing him on the coverage. Miami struggling last week against West Virginia, had a strong fourth quarter.
And that one right there is on Chuck Rodgers. That's one he's got to make. He makes a nice move and beats Marlon Jackson inside. Avoids the jam, doesn't get knocked off his route. Ball hit him right in the hands. That's one you need to do if you want to get back into this football game. You're going to your star. Your star's got to rise.
He's third in the country, averaging 119 yards per game, but only 79 yards in Big Ten games. Third and 9. Dardell has to throw it, but everyone is covered. Fumbles the ball, but it's out of bounds. Ernest Schaeser among the maize and blue chasing him. And that secondary, boy, there really was not much of an option for Dowdell.
Yeah, and you can see how Damon's limited in his ability to run the football because Ernest made up ground. I mean, big ground. He was taking 5 yards a hop. Right there, closed ground on Damon. Damon, you got to throw the ball away now. You don't eat the ball. Right here, see, now his eyes are looking for a place to go. But his eyes aren't looking downfield. Right here, you got to throw it away. So you're outside the tackle box. Go ahead and deliver it up to the fifth row.
timeout has been called by Michigan State, the second timeout that the Spartans have called this half. Jason Daly is going to have to punt this with his back up against the end of the end zone. Bobby Williams and company have some stuff. Is ready to punt from the back of his end zone after the third straight three and out for this Michigan State offense. Daly, line driver, but boy, he is pushing back. Marcus Curry fields it at his 43. And a nice tackle as he is ankled down, but Michigan will take over again in Michigan State territory. 52-yard punt, 12-yard return. Here's before the timeout,
yeah,
Chris.
Right here. Now, if you count all the guys that Michigan State has out there, that's 10. To me, now they have a what they call a launch pad. Here's a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. They have a what they call a launch pad over there for their special teams. Let's make sure we have enough people right there. You see this? It's like a bizarro game of Twister. Everybody line up on that if you're going out on special teams. If you're on special teams, get on there so we make sure we have enough people out so we don't have to waste the timeout to make sure we have enough people on the punt team. And I know that's irritating Coach Williams. And look, he's got a scowl on his face. He said, why do I have that green board there if nobody's going to stand on it?
Well, that was a holding penalty, by the way, against Michigan on that punt return, so that'll bring it back a little bit. But twice last week in that loss to Wisconsin, Michigan State had to call timeouts in the fourth quarter because they had 12 men on the field.
Yeah, and that's why they got the twister board over there. Line up on the board. How hard is it? If you're on punt team, get on the board.
And these are some of the criticisms that have been launched towards Bobby Williams and his staff. Williams now in his third season.
Well, let me say this. Now, the head coach should not have to worry about getting punt team guys there. The punt team coach or special teams guy or somebody's in charge of getting guys on the board so they can get out in the field. I'm not making excuses for Bobby. You got enough things going on to make sure that the punt team gets out on the field. Somebody's got to be able to handle that.
We got a little bit of a break after that holding call.
Nice.
Michigan back. That's a big pop for you, Chris.
Yeah, couple hit. Good three S's. Three S hit right there. And what happens, what do you do? Follow 44, and he'll take you to the ball if you're Michigan State.
Seth Mitchell, one of those guys with a hit on BJ Askew. Let's take a look now at this week's Aflac trivia question. Who are the two players in University of Michigan history to go on to be MVPs in the Super Bowl?
I know one.
Well, we need two. One won't work.
One is a... That's right.
But that's good, Chris. Good. Yeah. Think about the other one. We'll have the answer later on in the game. Second and nine. Play action. Boy, Navarre, lots and lots of time. Vickerson finally gets up close to him, and Navarre threw it away.
Now, that could be, to me, he's inside the tackle box. He throws it, a conscious decision to throw in the dirt, even though he throws it at Chris Perry. Some officials I've seen have called that intentional grounding because he was still inside the tackle box, and Chris Perry wasn't even looking for the ball. Chris Perry was in for protection.
At least he had the presence of mind to hit him, but obviously that was a throwaway as he got him around the ankle. He'd be really short to have a chance to catch that.
See, that's where Terry Malone likes to see him use his feet and get out and try to create.
Third and nine now. Michigan 3-5 on third down so far. Navarre deep drop. And that is an incomplete pass looking for Avant. Roderick Maples was all over.
Good coverage by Maples right there. Good timing of timeless hit the same time that the ball comes there. Now, I question that decision by John because they're in man-to-man coverage. Even though they would have caught the ball, chances are he would have been tackled because he did not throw the route that was past the sticks. Third and nine, get to the sticks. Look for your route to the sticks.
So after that incompletion, we get to finally see Adam Finley for the second time. Just gets that off. Zeal Kavanaugh backpedaling, gets it at his 16, and is caught from behind. It's John Shaw coming down to make the tackle from behind. So the Aflac trivia question, which two Michigan players went on to become Super Bowl MVPs? You know.
Yeah. One's got to be Desmond Howard, I believe.
And the other one is just this year.
Yeah.
There's your guy. Let's see, and that pose was struck against which team back there? A little scarlet, a little gray?
I can't see. Is that Indiana?
No, I believe
probably Indiana.
I think that's the Ohio State University.
I think it was Indiana. Bart Fox, our producer.
Bart protests that it was not Indiana. Sorry, Chris, it was OSU. Dowdell, that's a nice pass play. Something going now as he finds tight end Ryan Woods. He's a true freshman. Here's true blue Matt.
A nice little rivalry there in Iowa, Wisconsin.
Football game in the Big Ten this afternoon. Moss is taking it up to the 40, picking up five. And that last first down we saw from Michigan State was only its second of the game, Chris.
Yeah, see, but there, right there, I like the call because it was a bootleg and it gave Damon Dundell some options right there. Now they ran DeJuan Moss inside. Look, he's not a speedster. He's not going to beat anybody to the corner. Let him go inside out of that single back set. Give him that zone running play and let him hit it between the tackles. That's where he's most effective.
Showed it on that play. Moss continues to play the tailback position. Mark Goble now in as the fullback, and the fullbacks do not get carries in this Michigan State offense. Moss does as the tailback, and he runs for the first down, keeps his feet going into Michigan territory. A 13-yard gain, good effort by Moss.
Again, Pam, you know, where was the ball run? It was run inside. You'll see, this, they're running off Otney. They're all Big Ten center. Time to get a good pitch, good vision by Moss and keep his feet moving, protecting the football in traffic. I don't understand why they didn't come out running the ball inside. DeJuan Moss is not a perimeter runner. He's an inside runner, and that's the last time I'll say that again today.
There's a good look at Otney. He's got the tattoos going. We saw his photograph at the top of the show. He's got the center scowl on his face, one of the leaders on this offense. Dowdell getting around his fullback Goble and picked up a couple extra yards as he is pushed out around the 45-yard line, only picked up a couple.
See, now that play becomes effective when you're effective running the football, and that time Damon made a good decision. Although he had his tight end, Jason Randall, open on a crossing route, I don't think he looked for him because Jason was wide open sitting between safeties and linebackers on a crossing route. Jason's got to set it down, though. He kind of kept moving with Damon in a zone. A receiver downfield has to recognize that it's zone coverage. You sit down, sit your route down in man-to-man coverage. That's when you bring it across the field.
Numbers for Damon, 5 of 10 so far for 53 yards. And he has a couple of rushes for minus two. He picked up over 40 yards rushing, 47 yards rushing in last week's loss to Wisconsin. Again, he's playing on a bum ankle, and he one-hops that one to Rogers.
Yeah, see, now Charles Rogers is going to get a little frustrated here because Damon had him on a square end. Getting set up by the play action, it sucks the linebackers up. The linebackers got to read the high hats of the offensive lineman. When you see high hats, that means, okay, get depth. One underneath, one behind. Charles Rogers came in on an in route. Damon had him open, but he one-hopped it to him. Deliver the football, Damon. Be patient.
It's the third time, Chris, that Rogers has had a ball thrown to him. He has just one catch for 26 yards and a backup. That's Aaron Alexander, a redshirt freshman from Richmond, Virginia, a kid who has been literally in five practices all year, so they do not want to have to use him. Dowdell on his horse. And he is chased out of bounds near the line of scrimmage. So another fourth down coming up. Shanti Orr among those in pursuit.
Take a look here on Charles Rogers, and what you have to do is get a jam on him. That time Charles got jammed up at the line of scrimmage as he's jogging out the field. He's saying, man, I got to work on getting off those jams, because when I take it to the next level, they're going to jam a lot better than these guys jam.
Obviously, Rogers is the number one target for any defense. Make sure that he is covered, by far the most effective weapon for this team, but he has just one catch today. Jason Daly already working on his fourth punt of the day. Marcus Curry, where's that fair catch you love so much, Chris?
I don't get it. You got a 2-yard cushion. Make the catch, make somebody miss.
31-yard punt, and then the fair catch. Michigan going to take over on its 13-yard line. There is a penalty, though. It's a procedure call against Michigan State.
Actually, if you're Michigan now, you might want to think about declining this penalty because you're still in range where a kick can knock it up.
Illegal formation, offense. The penalty is declined.
There you go.
First down.
So Michigan does indeed decline the penalty and will take over from its 13. Been a very tough season so far for Bobby Williams, and a tough game so far as his team trails 21-3. Back in Ann Arbor, Michigan leading Michigan State 21-3. Michigan State struck first, but then Michigan behind John DeVar has come back to score three
John's
touchdowns.
John's doing great today. He's finding his receiver. He's going his first, second, third option. He's a big, tall guy. He reads the field well, and he's delivering the football today.
And he is back there again, giving it to Askew. If you're just joining us, Askew starting in place of. That adds up to 3 points so far for this Michigan State offense, which now at least is in the plus category with 16 yards rushing. Navarre for the big, big fullback Sanderson, but he can't hold on to it. Sanderson 6'3", 290 from Knoxville, Tennessee, a redshirt freshman.
Yeah.
And their offensive coordinator, Terry Malone, is excited about him, says he might turn out to be one of the best athletes on this team.
That kind of size, I'll tell you, he runs pretty well for 290 pounds, but Michigan got away with an offensive interference. That time Braylon came in, picked off who was covering Sanderson. They were lucky. That could have been a penalty. He's a good athlete for his size. He's 290. The defensive guys would be wanting him.
It looks like he's every bit of 290. Also, third and six after that incompletion. Navarre underneath completes it to Jopru, his tight end. And he gets the first down. Jopru extending. That's a 7-yard gain.
Now, there's a kid that's going to be drafted in the NFL. And I'm going to tell you why. Because watch him. He knows how to run routes. He knows where the sticks are. He's running across the route at the sticks. And you see where he catches that football? He catches the ball with his hands. And the transition from the catch to the run, it doesn't take him time to gather his feet. He gets it on the go. He's a big-time player. He's really come into his own this year, his final year at Michigan.
A career-high 32 catches for well over 300 yards and four touchdowns this season for Jopru. A lot of scouts are interested. Vickerson getting to John Navarre. First sack for Michigan State and the first sack for Vickerson this year.
Hey, don't point to yourself. Go high-five your teammates. Don't be talking. Just get to your teammates. You know, you guys, you see, he makes a nice move here. Vickerson comes and beats the guy inside. Nobody blocked him, and he secures the tackle and was trying to strip the ball. And this is all right. You know, you can celebrate, but celebrate with your teammates. Okay? Your defense isn't good enough right now to be celebrating yourself. Celebrate with your teammates.
That is only the 13th sack that Michigan State has gotten as a team all year. And again, the first for Vickerson. That was a 12-yard loss, so second and 22.
Beware of the screen pass to B.J. Askew.
Askew coming out. Here it comes, but he falls, and it's almost intercepted. That was Labinjo.
Yeah. And Labinjo is either has a headset up to this booth or he watches film and understands that B.J. Askew is their screen guy, especially out of single sets. And he's lucky. See, John's lucky here. B.J. gets tripped up by his more the offensive tackle. And here comes Labinjo. Good read. That's a big turnover Michigan State could have had.
Well, that was Courtney Morgan, the tackle who clipped him. So now third and 22. You run it to Askew, and he'll pick up a few. And Michigan will have to punt the football away.
Thomas Wright, I tell you, I like Thomas Wright coming up from the safety spot. That time again, he learned his lesson early in the game on B.J. Askew. He said, Chris, you're right, I got to bring my feet. That time he brought his feet, and he got him down. But if you don't bring your feet against B.J. Askew, you're going to go for a ride.
Charles Rogers is back to receive the punt from Michigan State. So Bobby Williams trying to get something going by putting his most talented weapon back by himself at the 40.
And you want to get him his touches. He's got to get touches on the ball. He's a big-time player.
Not getting him as a receiver. And he is dropped right away. A terrific tackle by Ernest Schaesel. And that is, by the way, the third punt return for Rogers this year, but it was for negative.
Both teams struggling offensively.
Opportunity to get it going as David Richard, the true freshman, picks up a few. Michigan State's first five possessions, well, the first one was good. Then it all went south on him, Chris.
Well, you see back there in the last possession, they have 35 yards right here, and how they got those 35 yards, they started running the ball inside. That time David Richards opposed to Juan Moss. But they see something in that defense that they can exploit inside, and they're doing it, and it also will set up their play-action game.
Richard has been pushing Moss for playing time at the tailback position. He's up close to a first down as we take you back. Thank you, Matt. Good one going on down there. Meanwhile, we have three tight ends in for Michigan State on third and one. The sun creeping through the clouds. Dowdell trying to do it on his own, and he cannot do it. In fact, he'll lose some real estate. And that's an interesting play call for a guy with a bad ankle.
I think he opened up the wrong way. Because there wasn't really a play fake. And I don't think Bobby's going to give it to him because you know he can't run outside because of the bad ankle. I think that's an MA. See, he's talking right there. Something happened. And it's interesting. See Marlon Jackson right here. Now he's a corner that can play the run. good transition.
Boy, the speed.
He does a good job of taking him out of bounds.
Unbelievable, the speed of some of these guys as they're going for it now on fourth and one. And this time, they give it to David Richard, and he is very close to the first down.
Yeah, I think he got the first down. They got a good initial surge up front on the offensive line, and David was able to break that 45-yard line.
Bobby Williams trying to exhort his troops on. It is indeed a Michigan State first.
Country, nice job. Appreciate it.
In Korea, where it is probably very early Sunday morning, Charles Rogers picking up about 8 yards on first down.
Now, Maurice Watts, the offensive coordinator from Michigan State, is doing a smart thing. He's got to get the guy his touches. You see Charles here on a reverse, does a good job of not selling it too early and getting in the open field and getting a nice pickup. There's Jackson again, making a nice field tackle. A good pursuit by the Michigan defense to bring him down. But at least Morris is saying, look, I got to get my star the ball.
He did it with the punt return. That didn't work, but that time he picked up 8. Here's Richard picking a nice little hole for himself and picking up about 3 on first down.
Yeah, they're receiving. Now, what Michigan State's doing is they're dominating that interior front. They're staying on their blocks well. See, they're big guys. They're big, real big guys. And these real big guys have trouble blocking out in space. What they're good at blocking at the point. They're starting to lean on Michigan's front 7 a little bit and pushing them back because there's nobody touching the running back beyond the line of scrimmage. He gets past the line of scrimmage before somebody gets a hand on him.
The skinniest guy on that offensive line is 295-pound Paul Harker. They are big guys. Dowdell rolling out. He's got a tight end, but looks like a little bit of indecision as he picks up a couple. Shaw making his third tackle.
Well, again, it was the bootleg pass. Jason Randall was covered that time on a crossing route. That time, Damon did a nice decision. Now, Knott's going to turn. Seems to see the quarterback point to a blue guy. Then you got to turn around and block. That time, Knott didn't turn around and block, or Damon Dowdell could have been still running. And when a quarterback points to somebody, turn and block that guy. You're not going to throw you the ball. Sorry.
Knott was very close to him, and it had to be obvious that he wasn't going to get the ball, and he did not, as you would say, put a hat on someone. The Dowdell this time goes back to Knott on the left side. That is good for another first down. Zach Kaufman makes the stop. 4 catches for Knott on the season, or on the game, excuse me, at 24 coming into this game.
It's just trips and a little option route. He's just going to run out and sit down. See, he reads zone coverage and he set his route down. Then he does a good job of the transition after the catch to get to the run, recognizing the weakness of the zone coverage, giving it to your open guy, your first receiver, which is not. It's a good job by Damon Dowdell, who's getting a little bit more confident as this game's going on.
And that's something that Morris Watt said that he saw in last week's game, even though they were beaten convincingly by Wisconsin. He said he saw Damon get into a sort of a comfort zone. Dowdell over the top for Rogers, and that falls incomplete. Shaw was on him, and Jeremy Lasore as well.
And that was a nice job by John Shaw, understanding in that coverage that he's inside help on a deep receiver. You see, he's going to run what they call a post route. He's going to set it. He's going to set Jack, set outside, come inside, and there's John Shaw staying deep as the deepest, and just gets a hand up there. That's good job by the safety helping out his corner.
Just to flick it away.
Nice throw. I guarantee you his corner, Shaw's corner, is helpful. Thank you.
Was there. Knott gets it down to the 25-yard line. That is his 5th catch. He has 4 more catches today than Charles Rogers, still sitting on that one catch for 26 yards that he got way back in the first quarter.
So Michigan's going to give that pass all day, and guess what? Damon Dowdell will take that all day. Now, what I'd like to see Knott do, he's a big guy. Charles Drake isn't that big of a guy. He's got to be able to break an arm tackle because he can be a weapon now. He's a big, thick guy. He's a 250-plus-pound tight end that can run.
In fact, he outweighs Charles Drake by about 60 pounds. They've already gone 40 yards on this 10-play drive, has Michigan State. Haven't scored since their very first possession of the game. Dowdell, short. Rogers tried to go back and get it, but couldn't quite.
Now, see, that's a pass he's got to catch. That was a well-thrown ball. Charles Rogers has got to catch that ball. Hit your hands, that's the rule.
Rodgers is a guy who we have all seen make some spectacular catches this season. We did the Cal game week three of the season, and he dropped a couple that were right to him.
Yeah, he dropped a couple.
And that was a disastrous game for Michigan State. Dave Rayner made his first field goal from 39 yards, first possession of the game. This is from 42. The Michigan crowd screaming all the way. They knew it was no good, and it was not. To Rayner, a guy who has hit a 53-yarder and a 50-yarder this year, misses.
Well, here's what you got to do when you have an opportunity to put points on the board. You need to put points on the board. When you have an opportunity to catch the ball, you're an All-American. Catch the ball.
Ulish Booker, the big 6'7", 300-pound senior tackle, helped off the field after the field goal attempt by Dave Rayner was no good, and Michigan has it back. Up the middle, Askew. So that was a good drive put together by Michigan State, but it all came to naught as Rayner was unable to kick the field goal. And as we went to break, we saw that pass that Rodgers should have caught.
That was a well-thrown ball by Michigan. Charlie Rodgers got to bring that one in and get yourself a first down. You're the All-American. They're counting on you to make the catch. Make it.
He is a terrific football player. 10 semifinalists for the Blitnikoff Award this year. Did not catch that pass. Navarre to Jocru, his tight end. And Jocru has a nose for that first down stick. He's got another one. Let's go to Matt Weiner.
Pat, coming up on the Saturn Halftime Report, a kid from Coral Gables and a coach used to roam the halls at Miami, given the number one team in the country all sorts of problems. We'll check around the Big Ten, including that Wisconsin-Iowa game. The Hawkeyes have their hands full. Plus, we'll look ahead to all the afternoon action. Mark May and I at the half.
Thank you, Matt. We will catch you then as Braylon Edwards catches that pass. Robert Nelson making the stop. Picked up 7 yards of Michigan with a minute and a half counting to go, trying to get on the board before the half expires.
It's interesting to watch John Navarre run his two-minute offense and where he's getting his plays called from is the backup quarterbacks. It's not any coaches on the field, it's the quarterbacks on the field.
No play. Michigan perhaps not set for the snap.
Prior to the snap, false start, offense. 5 yards, the down remains second.
Coach Carr saying, come on, let's run this two-minute drill. Right here, see these two guys on headsets right here? They're in contact with Terry Malone. Now, they're the ones calling and signaling the plays in. You won't see that too often. Usually it's a coach. The Michigan wants their quarterbacks involved in the game, so they call the plays. They signal plays in.
As their first-string quarterback, Navarre, goes down, Brandon McKinney and Darrell Hamilton engulf him, and now little extracurriculars on the stop there. I guess if you're a backup quarterback like Brenton and Gutierrez, these are guys who are not going to get them a lot of playing time. That should be good for them to get into it.
Yeah, and it keeps them in the game and it gives them a sense of purpose into a game. So they have to keep their minds into it. And what I'm a big believer in, and I know for quarterbacks, since you're not getting a lot of game time reps, is visualization and what reads you would make if this play was called for you. Both these guys know the play and they get it.
Now with a sprained left shoulder.
Boy, that is tough. Thank you, Rob, for a defensive line already depleted by Greg Taplin's suspension. Now their two starting defensive ends are out. Ronald Bellamy going up and bringing it down in Michigan State territory. First down.
That was a rope thrown by John Navarre, and that's where 6'6 helps him, where he can sit back, survey the field, and throw over the offensive line. He doesn't need to find a passing lane. He just throws over the top of everybody at the height that he plays at. It's 6'6.
6'6, he's 6 inches taller than the receiver Bellamy. And now he's going back to Braylon Edwards, who had to turn around and could not gather it in.
Yeah, as good a throw as the last one was, that was a bad throw because Bellamy was wide open on the curl route because Benny Joppu ran down the middle of the field, which took the safety in the corner and let Bellamy, or Edwards, excuse me, or who was it? Bellamy
Edwards, and Braylon Edwards.
Yeah, Braylon Edwards, thank you. Curled up, he's got to make that catch.
All right, he was thrown behind him, and if he would have got him on the dead run, it'd be a big play out of that.
Got to hit that one.
Second and 10 after the incompletion. Three receivers in for the Wolverines, and that's not going to go. Flags are down. Navarre throws it to Edwards, and that's off his hands. That one was incomplete. Avant moved off the line of scrimmage right before the snap, and then some Michigan State guys moved.
Yeah, Jason Avant, a little anxious. He was lined up on the line of scrimmage. He wanted to readjust his alignment so they wouldn't have too many on the line. Got a little bit of a hurry.
Yep, and that's the call, the illegal motion. Avant, only a true freshman out of Chicago with that mistake.
Illegal motion, offense. The penalty is declined. Third down.
So you decline it because now it's third and 10. With 41 seconds left to go in this first half. Three receivers to the right of John Navarre. Is looking towards Calvin Bell. First time he's thrown towards him, but that one falls incomplete.
Good job by Michigan State's rushing three, dropping eight. Calvin Bell was open. I see Calvin Bell playing a little defense and offense, pulling a Chris Gamble from Ohio State. But Calvin was open again. John threw the ball behind him, but good job of pressuring three defensive linemen for the Spartans.
Well, that's a big stop too for Michigan State to keep Michigan off the board before they go into the dressing rooms. And Adam Finley in for his fourth punt. Zeal Kavanaugh is back deep, not Rogers this time. Good hang time on that punt. Kavanaugh escapes the first wave, but not the second, as he is dragged down at the 9-yard line. 3-yard return on a 42-yard punt. Last year, Pittsburgh did win that game last year, is DeJuan Moss. And Michigan State going to be content to just let the first half run down. So Michigan State got off to a good start, scoring a field goal on its very first possession, but then Michigan came back with three touchdowns on three straight possessions. And the Spartans, losers of five of their last six, will go into the locker room down 21-3 to Michigan. Bobby Williams digging his team out of yet another hole. Let's take by California, and it has gone downhill steadily since. They've only beaten Northwestern since. Phillip Rabs kicking off to start the second half, and Jaron Hayes from Michigan State gets it past the 26. A yellow flag flies late.
That's another thing that's killing Michigan State, which they need to avoid. The sexy Bobby gets mad at that. He should, because those penalties can be avoided.
Every single scoring opportunity. Push back to the 10, and DeJuan Moss is pushed back himself.
See, I don't understand. Now, the whole second quarter, where were you successful running the football? Inside. So what they do, they try to get DeJuan Moss outside. Carl Diggs from his middle linebacker spot chases him down because DeJuan Moss does not have the speed to be a perimeter runner.
Moss again, the converted fullback. He had six carries for 18 yards in the first half. And he lost 2 yards on the first carry of the second half.
Now that's something, you know, that's frustrating. Frustrating up here.
Imagine how frustrating it must be for them down there. Dowdell on the run, connects with B.J. Lovett. And Lovett picks up 10. They'll be 2 yards short of the first down.
Well, this is what they call a dash. The quarterback's going to dash out. You'll have people block to contain people, so the quarterback has time to look for people downfield. That time, Damon threw to B.J. Lovett. Now, B.J. caught the ball and didn't make the transition to the run. He did a little shimmy shake, and he didn't have to. There was nobody to shimmy shake. All he had to do was turn and run upfield. They would have had a first down, but the shimmy shake cost him 3 yards.
Cost him.
Whatever a shimmy shake is, I'll figure that one out later.
It's not good when you don't need the shimmy shake. That's B.J.'s first catch of the day. Third and two. Up top. That ball was in the air for a long time as Charles Rogers got it, and they're short of the first down, or maybe they get a favorable spot. That's only the second catch for Rogers.
Yeah, if you go by that orange arrow, then he's short, but I'm going to tell you, Charles Rogers runs the option route, but Damon waited too long to deliver the football to him. And Charles got to take it upfield a little bit further and get past the sticks just in case you have to come back for the ball. You could come back and still have the first down, but it was a slow read by Damon Dowdell.
Here's a guy who catches, on average, about six balls a game, and that's just his second today, Chris.
Yeah, that's his second one today, and, you know, he's dropped two.
Only had three touches in the first half. The one reception, the one punt return, and one carry, a rush for 8 yards. So Michigan State has to punt it. That's good coverage downfield by that Michigan State. on the bar trying to bring it from Michigan, up 21-3. There's Askew. Big hole, and he lunges forward for the Michigan first down, picking up 11.
Again, he's falling at 290-pound fullback in Sanderson. And on Michigan State defense, I am following Sanderson. When there's two backs in the backfield, he's going to take me to the ball.
An 11-yard rush, Chris, the best for Michigan today. Askew in the first half had 18 carries for 63 yards. Picked up the first down. They go right back. Picks up about three. Let's go down the field. And Rob Stone, Rob.
Well, Pam, I had a chance to shimmy shake with both coaches at halftime. Lloyd Carr told me overall he's very pleased with this team, except for maybe the last two offensive series. No real adjustments or major concerns he had going to the locker room. Bad news though for the Spartans, both Booker and Dukes done for the day. Bobby Williams asked him, hey, Dowdell had success running, you're going to stick with it? He said yeah, and also he needs big plays from his big players. Charles Rogers, that means you, friend.
What do you think his shimmy shake would be like?
A mad one right now.
As Navarre goes up top, good adjustment by Braylon Edwards, who gathered it in front of Broderick Nelson. Close to another Michigan first down.
Okay, this is a pass now. If you're seeing the two-back set and you understand the two-back set, why is it a pass? Because this guy, their angle, their depth is different. So when their depth is closer to the quarterback, it's going to be a pass, so they get to protection and timing route. That time Edwards does a good job of bringing it in with his hands and fighting for extra yardage. Good pass on time by Navarre.
And Edwards is a kid who really wasn't that highly recruited coming out of high school. He played at two high schools, so they really didn't throw him the ball much. That was indeed a first down reception for Brandon. Here's Perry, Chris Perry, who did not start a tailback today, still nursing a sore ankle, picks up four on that carry.
So the one thing to look for, if you're a defensive coach out there and you're playing a team that runs two backs, look for the depth of the backs from the quarterback, and also the relationship between the fullback and the tailback. If they're close together, usually it's a pass. If there's a tailback is lined up at 6 or 7 yards, usually it's a run so he can get the ball and read where the hole is to run the football.
So looking at this formation, you would think?
I'd say pass.
That's exactly what Navarre does. Looking down the field for Bellamy, and he is unable to bring it in.
Got a flag down there on the M.
Yep. Boy, Bellamy looked like he was in good position to catch it as he was covered by Ashton Watson.
Now, I'm going to see what this call is, because I thought Ashton Watson did a good job of looking and leaning at the very last second to break up the play. What one thing Ashton Watson showed, he was beat, but he showed good recovery speed.
Pass interference, defense, 15 yards from the previous spot.
I want to take a look at this because I thought he did a good job here. He arrived when the ball arrived. You see it right here. Now, Bellamy's got great speed. Now, Ashton right here. Now, turn and look. See, right there, I think they got him with that left hand. That left hand was on him and slowed up Bellamy. He does not quit on the ball, but the left hand he uses as like a stopper, trying to slow him down. The left hand was doing the old hook move.
Did a good job after that of grabbing the ball away from Bellamy, but the interference call puts it first down at the 20. Perry picking up about three. And remember, Bellamy caught a touchdown pass from Navarre, a 38-yarder, beautifully thrown ball back in the
second. Edwards.
He's looking for him, Chris. Oh, good break on the ball by Nelson.
See, now what they're starting to do, and why I can point that out, is because they're repeating plays. He's the only wide receiver out. His split was cut back to the inside, giving him room to run the outcut. And also the back's relationship was close to the quarterback, and they were close to each other. And right here is a great close. Nice job. And Broderick Nelson getting that long arm across. Not using the short arm, but getting a long arm. And avoiding contact, get the long armor. That a boy. Good job. Good coverage.
Second year starting at corner for Nelson, who was an honorable mention all Big Ten last season. Third and six. Navarre, no chance at all. That is Monquiz Wedlow, the linebacker, coming in. Finley in now to try a 40-yard field goal. Made one against Iowa, the only attempt of his collegiate career. Made that last week. They've had trouble in the kicking game. And won't you know it, Finley misses that time.
Man, Coach Carr said anytime there's a field goal, it's an adventure.
And not a good adventure usually. It hasn't been that way for Michigan this year. Finley misses. It's still 21-3. Lloyd Carr, in his eighth year as the head coach of Michigan back in 1997, led them to a perfect season and a national championship. But a little bit of consternation in this area because they were defeated so handily here by Iowa last week, losing 34-9. But so far, so good against Michigan State here. Dowdell in the air for Rogers, double covered. Charles Drake got a hand on it. Let's go back to one tough kid for Wisconsin, but knocked out of that game. Big Ten standings, Iowa and Ohio State don't play this year.
Well, that's a shame, too. You always like to see the two top teams play each other, battle out on the field.
Especially when they're unbeaten in the league. Yeah. David Richard picking up a couple as we take you back to those standings.
Yeah, and just a quick note too, Pam, that if both of them finish the rest of the way on, don't lose any more games, Ohio State gets the tiebreaker according to the Big Ten rules because of the better overall record.
Because Iowa does have that one loss, yeah. The blemish on its record. And
against Iowa State.
Iowa State, back when the Cyclones were playing really terrific football earlier in the season. And it is too bad that they don't play all the non-conference games,
right.
Gobble up so much. It would be nice if they could play everybody in the Big Ten every year. That one is almost intercepted. Good job. Marlon Jackson again, yeah. 6-1 and skying to get a hand on it.
See, Marlon understands, too, that the Bobby must have heard Rob Stone's interview saying that we're going to get the ball to her. Charles Rogers got to make plays, and Marlon Jackson just sitting back in his cover, too, favoring Charles Rogers as opposed to taking not right there that was open underneath and possibly could have ran for the first down if David Dowdell would deliver him the football.
So that one incomplete as Rogers unable to get to it. Another good play by Jackson. Daly, boy, a little bit of pressure, is able to get it off. Marcus Curry fields it and then picks up a yard or two. Good field position again for Michigan. They'll take the ball over at the 47, leading the Spartans 21-10. Back to Ann Arbor. Here's an historic play by Marlon Jackson with that pass broken up. The last offensive play of this game going for Charles Rogers. He has now tied the Michigan season record by breaking up 15 passes. Charles did it back in 1996.
Yeah, and well on his way to breaking it because he does have a nose for the football. But the thing that has impressed me most today about Marlon Jackson is that he's a big physical corner that can come up and also support the run, which will do him well when he takes it to the next level.
Again, he's only a sophomore here at Michigan, and so valuable. Tough to find corners, obviously, who can cover and hit like he does, and he showed right there that he can get up with the best of them, as he has had to cover one of the best receivers, if not the best receiver in the country, in Rogers all day.
And you see Michigan State Broderick Nelson being helped off the field. Shot of Jimmy Herm. There's Broderick being helped off the field. That's a guy that can't lose. That's a corner. Playing with young corners out there now. They've already had injury problems.
Yep. And we have him with six tackles already today. Nelson playing a solid game. Michigan coming right back with Askew. And he is collared by Ronald Stanley, but not before he picked up 5 yards. As we take you back. Thank you, Matt. Oklahoma State trying to pull away a little bit in that game in the second quarter. Here at 2nd and 6, Michigan leading Michigan State 21-3. Askew again, this time along the right side, and he picks up a Wolverine first down. Seth Mitchell with the stop, but that's 8 more yards for Askew, and Michigan's number one priority running the football today, and they've been able to do it fairly well.
That time, Roderick Maples from his left cornerback position has a chance to come up and make the play. And Askew, being an experienced runner, kind of made a cut inside, avoiding Maples and getting positive yards. But Maples was the on-block player. He's got to make the play if you're the on-block player on defense.
And instead, 8 more yards for Askew. He now has 89 yards on the day and a touchdown. They go right back to him, and Askew, Rasmussen can't quite get him at the point of contact, so he stumbles forward to pick up 3.
But Rasmussen does a good job of getting penetration with a blocker hanging on him. At least gets an arm on him to slow him down and let the S helmets get over there to help him out. Good penetration by Rasmussen, beating Benny Joppu off the hook. See, disengages,
has a blocker hanging on him, slows down, asks you, give him a chance for the S helmets to get over there and help out.
So sort of an assist for Rasmussen, who is a defensive tackle by trade, but has been forced to play defensive end today because of the suspension of Taplin and now the injury to Clifford Dukes. Michigan's rushing yards now up to 86 as a ball club. On second and eight. Moore asks you, good little hole that closes up quickly, however. Thomas Wright making yet another stop, and we take it about. Thanks, Matt. Northwestern fighting valiantly to try to get that first win in the Big Ten. And Brad Banks, last week, you've talked about this guy all season, Chris.
Yeah, he's kind of exploded on the scene. I'll tell you, he's got a nice target, Dallas Clark, a tight end. He's a big-time weapon.
And that was last week right here in the Big House. It was a big catch by Braylon Edwards. Another first down as he is tackled down at the 25.
Here comes a 15-yarder, too.
Late penalty flag as Michigan State continues to get itself into deeper trouble. Four catches now for Braylon Edwards, and Bobby Williams wants an explanation.
Yeah, let's see what happens here, because this is something that a coach can't control.
After the play, personal foul, defense, half the distance to the goal line, first down.
Now see, that's if you're a team that's in disarray, this is what happens when you get frustrated. You start taking shots that you don't need to take. That's a reflection of the head coach. I know that he can't stand for that. But if a guy does that and your team is in trouble and your discipline might be a problem, then you start yanking guys out of there for those kind of dumb mistakes.
Again, the defensive coordinator, Bill Miller, said that. It's just a matter of getting the right guys in there, guys who play hard but play smart. Five penalties now for 51 yards. First and 10. Perry been bottled up pretty well by this defense. Kevin Vickerson making the stop.
Yeah, that was a good job of penetration. And Bill Miller said one thing about some guys taking plays off. I tell you, I haven't seen a lot of the S helmets on defense take plays off. Michigan State has played hard. And I think that's one thing you can expect when you play your rival school in Michigan, that these guys will step up to the challenge. And at the very least, play with great effort.
And those comments, not just coming by the coaching staff, some of the Michigan State players have, in fact, said that. Jason Randall, the tight end, among those who went on the record with that, saying some of my guys are not playing hard every down, which must frustrate these guys who do play hard every down. Navarre, oh, that's incomplete, looking for Massaquoi, a freshman tight end. Cedric Henry on Ashton Watson on the stop.
Yeah, Ashton does a good job. It's a poorly thrown ball by Navarre. Now, when you have a seven cut, is a corner route. That was by the tight end. Now what you want to do is throw the ball high and outside, not low and inside. That time he underthrew, he relied too much on his arm strength. That's where you like to see Navarre throw the nice high touch pass.
Robert Nelson over there on the sidelines, the cornerback who went off and is being looked at, and they're missing him on the field now. Pursuit, Navarre gets it off in time to jump through the tight end, who takes it in for yet another Wolverines touchdown.
Yeah, what that was, the old tight end sneak. The tight end's going to kind of hide behind everybody like they block it down like a run. Then he's going to sneak into the flat, outrun everybody. Navarre looked for him all the way. Jopru did a good job of selling it, got open and scored points.
Point is good, and Michigan now extends its lead to 28-3. Another touchdown catch for Jopru, second of the season, fifth of his career, and now they're starting to pull away. Jopru's with his fifth touchdown catch of the season. Michigan has now extended its lead over Michigan State to 28-3, scoring 28 unanswered points. Grabs kickoff. Michigan State taking over now at the 20.
There you go. This is a Sam Weich play. It's a tight end hide play. You'll see the tight end right here. See, that's Benny Jopru right there. And on the snap of the ball, what he's going to do, he's going to come down, and he's going to see he's like blocking right there. He's pretending he's blocking. Then he keeps going, and he sneaks all the way across the field where John Navarre has to hang in there and deliver the football. That's a design play. He's the number one option. That's a great red area call. It's a big red zone call for all coaches, but not many can execute it like Benny Jopru and John Navarre.
Drive covered 53 yards, and the closest guy to him is Moss gets the carry, and he picks up about six. On that replay, we saw Askew, the big 6'6", 295-pound defensive end. He was the closest guy to Benny. No way he was going to get to him.
No, Benny can run. Benny's a good runner, fast runner.
Good runner, and they're impressed with his blocking as well, kind of the complete package.
Yeah, and the best thing about him is his hands. He has great soft hands for a bigger guy, big tight end type guy. When tight ends are not only making a comeback in college football, but in the NFL, tight end is becoming a premium position again.
So valuable when you have those guys who can do things like drop through, stretch the field, be another weapon. Moss had no shot on that. Sean Lazarus making the stop.
Well, penetration kills anything inside. That time Sean Lazarus comes around his block, beats the player, and makes a solid hit behind the backfield on the tight running. Juan Moss. Good job by that.
He's an Ohio guy.
He gets skate.
Canal Fulton, Ohio. Some Ohio guys end up in the maize and blue.
Yeah. Desmond Howard, Elvis Gerbach.
Cleveland guys.
St. Joe's, yeah.
Yeah. Played on the...
Charles Woodson, Fremont Ross.
Came up here and did some things for Michigan. Third and five. Look at that. 1 of 10 on third down so far for the Spartans. Dowdell goes down. Grant Bowman, another Ohio guy. He's from outside of Columbus. Blacklick, Ohio. That's a sack. Michigan State has to punt.
Yeah, they're smelling blood. See, when you get that blood smell, that's when you unleash it. They run a nice little TE game right there. Grant Bowman comes inside. That's a TT game, actually. Tackle and tackle, making a move. And he does a good job of wrapping up Grant Bowman.
Bowman's mom drives around in Columbus with a Michigan license plate frame and said she actually was stopped by a cop once and said, what the heck are you doing with that license plate frame?
That cop's doing his duty.
Not good. In Columbus, flags down as Marcus Curry returns the Jason Daly punt into Michigan State territory. Only a 35-yard punt, 13-yard return. But check out the flag first. So that's a cop doing his duty, huh?
Absolutely.
Columbus.
Yeah, in Columbus it is.
No Michigan stuff. Game of the season, and they were using three tailbacks. And now they're using him primarily. First down, LeVar to Jopru. Picks up about five. And gets hands full today, trying to take down Alabama. So later on today, big SEC game. A lot of people pointing towards that Georgia-Florida game. Perry. Thomas Wright wraps him up about a yard short of the first down. We're going to take you down to the field now, and Rob Stone.
Right. Pam, Michigan State now without their third player. Broderick Nelson is out for this game. They were very concerned about his neck, and it appears that he had some feeling issues in his arms, and that made the Michigan State staff say, take off your helmet, go inside, and they're going to x-ray his neck right now.
Wow, Rob, so thank you, Bobby Williams. Boy, from bad to worse.
Injuries are starting to pile up. They're playing with a bunch of young kids out there right now. They're fighting.
Nelson, the senior, out for the rest of the game. Perry picks up the first down with interest. We're now 8 for 14 on first down. Excuse me, that was B.J. Askew in for Perry.
See, I like B.J. Askew. Why I like him, because he's a north-south guy. He's a one-cutter hitting. He's not going to do any dancing or running on eggs. He's going to one cut it, hit it, and he blasts it up in there, and he always falls forward.
6'3", 235-pounder from Cincinnati, Ohio.
Yep.
All over the place, Chris.
they know where to come to get good football players.
Tell you this.
Oh, he got him.
He's got him. That is Bellamy. Touchdown all the way, Wolverines.
He got him on the out and up. Run down to the fire hydrant, fake it, then go to the parked car. He got him.
That is a 47-yard touchdown pass to Bellamy. He had a 38-yarder back in the second quarter.
You see a true freshman, Ashton Watts, says, I want to make a big play. Uh-oh, Bellamy says, no, I got something for you. I'm not going out there. I'm going down here. And John DeVar threw air under, let Bellamy run underneath it. Great pass, great catch, great call.
And that is a 35-3 lead. John DeVar has run for a touchdown and thrown for three more.
The
And he's the guy that was under some criticism, under some heat. Okay, a nice little pump fake, and Bellamy hits it up on the pump fake, takes off down the field. And see, that was air under that ball. That gives your receiver a chance to run and get it. Then try to put it on the line. You knew he was so wide open, you want to put plenty of air on it just in case he has to make an adjustment. Great job of catching the ball first, then taking it into the end zone. Ashton Watson's going to be a good football player, a true freshman. Learned a lesson. Don't bite on the out and up.
Yeah, it's a tough lesson to learn on national TV. Bellamy, 124 yards on five catches, 124 yards and two TDs, both career highs for the senior from New Orleans.
He's impressive today. Both he and Braylon Edwards, both of them impressive. Wide receivers, big kids. Using a good job catching the ball with their hands.
And they complement each other well, Bellamy and Braylon Edwards.
And they spread the ball around too nice.
Yep, that's the game plan for Terry Malone.
He does it too. And then you throw Jacquel into the mix.
Imagine if they had a really good, effective running game.
I think they do with B.J. Askew.
All right, B.J. Lovett coming back the other way from Michigan State. Is pushed out of bounds by Brandon Williams. Start around the 34. John DeVar, maybe the criticism will stop. There's that touchdown run. And then three of these. Bellamy first. Add one to Jacquel in the middle, and then that beauty to Bellamy again. 16 of 27, 229 yards, no picks. Three throwing touchdowns and one rushing TD for Mr. Navarre.
Yeah, he's making great decisions, too. And he throws the deep ball extremely well.
Remember, Navarre is only a junior, so he'll be back here next year. Play action, Dowdell, there's all along. Boy, he had Jason Randall, but threw to the wrong side. And it's time to go.
You might want to think about bringing Aaron Alexander in right now, because Damon Dowdell is struggling, and you don't want to take his confidence, but you want to get some the other kids some experience.
You would do that with a redshirt freshman who has five practices his entire collegiate career, or this year at least.
What do you got to lose?
Randall, that time Randall and Dowdell connect. First down at midfield.
I understand your point, but you don't have anything to lose. Damon's struggling on that ankle. He had a wide open receiver for 20 yards downfield. And you don't want to be too hard on the guy, but you got to throw it to him.
He has missed some receivers, and you see Alexander got the stocking cap on, not even close to, to warm it up. He's had five practices all year because he broke his left foot very early in 2 days, and they just really got him back last week and pressed into the backup role because of the situation with Jeff Smoker. That's a completion to David Richard, the tailback, dragging some Michigan guys out with him. Should be another first down.
Pam, adding to Alexander's situation, very athletic player. Tom Izzo had him on the hoops team last year when the Cagers were down a couple men, so he's very athletic. Threw a 44-yard strike to Rodgers last week, but he is very involved in this game as well, Pam. He is working the sidelines more than Bobby Williams is, trying to keep everybody's head up. Not bad for a guy who's literally a third-string quarterback.
Thanks, Robin. Now, of course, the second-string quarterback. Good size on him, 6'5", 191. He did play six games, but all of 4 minutes for the Spartans basketball team last year. That is the end of the third quarter, so Michigan State will go to the fourth quarter down 35-3. Benny Jacquel and the rest of the guys in the maize and blue putting on a show in Ann Arbor, trying to make people forget about what happened against Iowa last week. We are back in Ann Arbor, Michigan. Pam Ward, Chris Spielman, and Rob Stone joining you from the campus of the University of Michigan for the backyard brawl that has been decidedly in favor of the home team. Dowdell, there's Randall again for another first down connection. Charles Drake making the stop.
Well, that time, good call by Maurice Watts, offensive coordinator for Michigan State, going back to a play that was open earlier. Damon couldn't deliver the ball. That time he delivered it right in the hands of his big tight end, Randall.
And he picked up 20 on that one, Chris, and they get it down to the 19-yard line. Michigan State's ninth first down of the game. Michigan has 22 of them. Rodgers split to the left. That's where Dowdell is looking all the way in the end zone. And Rodgers, oh, cannot bring it in. as he tried to make yet another patented Rodgers spectacular catch.
That's a well-thrown ball. That's three well-thrown balls in a row by Damon Dowdell. That time he put it where he needed to be. And I, you know, I'm not trying to be hard on Charles Rodgers, but this is a catch you got to make. And the only reason I say that, because it's in his hands. That's a good job of Curry coming in and getting a hand in there. But right there, you got that ball in your hands. Good job of coverage. Excellent job.
And also right up against the
Marcus Curry.
Yeah, Marcus Curry, number 30 on the coverage, right up against the corner of that end zone as well. Rodgers has been thrown to 8 times today, has made 2 catches. Over the middle, that is a little bit too far looking for Ryan Woods. We look. Thank you, with Bollinger on the sidelines. Northwestern looking for its 3rd win of the year, the other 2 against Duke and Navy. Not a banner year in Evanston.
Yeah, well, and Indiana's not a banner year either if you're getting beat by the Northwestern. Nothing against Northwestern, it's not strong as yet.
That is another throw to Rodgers, double covered, Marlon Jackson among them, as Dowdell tried to force that in.
Now, is that considered a PBU by our stat guy? Is that a PBU? Because that would break the record. Got a hand on it.
No, it is not considered a PBU.
Oh, man.
Tough.
Some
statisticians tough today.
Got a hand on there. That's a PBU in my book.
He is now tied with Charles Woodson for most in the single season history of Michigan. 4th and 10, what the heck, go for it. 3 receivers to the left. And he's going down the middle, nothing doing. Eric Knott, the tight end, in the vicinity. Jeremy Lasore covering him. Bobby Williams' team gives up the football on down. The Spartans had their deepest penetration of the game, getting it all the way down to the 19-yard line, but a 4th down pass to Eric Knott was incomplete. So Michigan takes over on downs. Up 35-3. BJ Askew picks up a little bit. Let's take you down to Rob Stone.
Yeah, Pam, we're hanging by with a guy who had some pretty good hands here in his days in Michigan, Anthony Carter. And tell me a little bit about the Michigan-Michigan State rivalry.
That's a big rivalry. It's something that I wasn't aware of because I came from Florida. But I had 2 guys that played on Michigan State, Eugene Burroughs and Bernard Haye. At that time was on Michigan State team. So it was kind of like a bragging right for myself during the summer.
I got to ask you, what's up with the throwing of the marshmallows from your Michigan fans?
You know what, I've been to several games, and I at least try to catch 2 games out of you, and this is the first time I've ever been hit, so I can accept it.
Hey, you and me and Spielman will go up there. We'll take care of business, all right?
No problem at all. Thank you.
Anthony, thank you.
All right.
Thanks, Rob, and also Anthony Carter. That's a 10-yard gain.
I had the great pleasure of playing with Anthony Carter. He's just an amazing guy, amazing receiver, just explosive. They're exploiting our own producer, Bart Fox's Indiana Hoosiers. But AC was just a true professional, great guy, and a tremendous athlete, and a great person.
All records, man.
Yeah, he has it all.
And went on, that was a 1st down carry for Askew, who's now gone over the 100-yard mark, rushing. Carter, a terrific pro career as well, with the Vikings mainly. Perry picks up a couple. We'll take it. Time left in that one. And the running into the offensive lineman, we saw it with the Bengals last week, almost had their first win of the season, and then Matt O'Dwyer got in the way of the running back, and the Bengals lost again.
Hey, he actually tripped over another lineman.
That's double not good. 2nd down carry for Perry. Mentioned that Askew had gone over the 100-yard mark. So Michigan trying to get that running game going. They've done a very good job of it today.
You know, you have injury problems, and I'll tell you why, because Michigan State now has gone to number 74. You see, he's running out right now. Alphonso Townsend, who's playing defensive line, the only problem is he's not a defensive lineman. He's an offensive line. So they're just kind of finding bodies to put in there to play defense. But I'll give Bobby credit, because the one thing his guys are not doing is they're not quitting, and that is always a direct reflection of the head football coach.
And now on 3rd and 2, Perry running for another Michigan 1st down. He gets into Michigan State territory, downed at the 45. 17 yards for Perry.
They're starting to get worn down a little bit, but that doesn't mean they're quitting. That's it. Chris Perry is a guy that wants to get back in the action. Why? Because B.J. Askew looks pretty good.
That's right. Over 100 yards for B.J. Perry coming off the bench today because he has a little bit of an ankle injury, and the Michigan offense trying to get it going on the ground. They've done that against Bobby Williams' team, which again coming into this game was 99th in the country, giving up 197 yards per game on the ground. And Perry picks up about six more. Michigan looking to run this clock down a little bit and get out of here with a victory.
One thing to point out now, at least in the local media, it's been emphasized, is that the Bobby Williams and Lloyd Carr don't exactly exchange greeting cards. They're not their best of friends. And it kind of carries over, either consciously or subconsciously. You want to beat your opponent. And the head coach plays the head coach. In fact, I was talking to Bo Schembechler yesterday for about a half hour. I'll tell you what he told me.
First, we'll watch the second and fourth play. Askew's turn to carry the ball, trying to get around the corner, and he does nicely. Thomas Wright corrals him, but it's another Michigan first down.
And I sat down in Bo's office with him for about a half hour, and we're talking, and my coach at Ohio State, Earl Bruce, is getting inducted into the College Football Hall of Fame. And the one thing he said, man, that little SOB could coach. I used to hate coaching against him. But I love to beat him, though. But he's actually, they were great respect for each other. They're going to go down there, and he's going to be there for Coach Bruce's ceremony. But goes to show you that these guys have their own little personal competition going on between each other.
Boy, those were kind of the glory days back then. And Bo was here in Michigan. You had Woody Hayes and then Earl Bruce. Fun stuff from a fan's point of view. Askew having fun, running rampant. Thomas Wright now in 11 tackles for him. Matt Weimer. So they went for it, didn't get it, and they're still leading that football game. Boy, what an upset that would be. First and goal from the 9. Askew picking his way through the white jerseys. Tackled down at the 3 by Wright again. Thomas Wright could be one sore puppy.
Yeah, he is. And the only problem with Thomas is that, you know, they're getting to the second level easily. And when you get to the second level easily, that means a big back like B.J. Askew has some momentum build up. And for Thomas Wright, he says, look, guys, at least try to slow him up. I'll make the tackle, but at least try to slow him up. But he's a guy that shows a lot of grit today because he's making a lot of plays, and he's tackling high, taking a big man up high and taking that challenge.
And Wright is one of the guys who was pointed out by Bill Miller, actually the only guy pointed out by Bill Miller as being someone who's playing particularly well this season. Askew stopped just short of the goal line that time. Wedlow on the stop. And a team looking for leadership. Of course, Jeff Smoker out. And Thomas Wright, the leader on the other side of the defense. He's the captain on that side. And one of the few guys who was actually the only captain last week who went out and talked to the media after that bad loss at home to Wisconsin.
Yeah. You know, there was dissension, too, between the offense and defense last week. There was almost a fight in the locker room.
Right, Charles Rogers stepping in between some folks. And these are media guys, the vast majority, obviously, are Michigan guys, local guys. And the story will continue. The intrigue will continue on the Michigan State side. Askew, touchdown, Michigan. Making it look easy this afternoon. That's his second.
Well, if you're Michigan, there's no better way to counter an embarrassing loss to come back and deliver a butt whooping on somebody else. And right now, that's what they're doing to the Spartans.
Finley in for the extra point. John Navarre is his holder. And Finley knocks that home. And the lead has been extended to 42-3, an 11-play drive. All of them rushes. Askew, a career-high 149 yards. That's his second score of the day. That's a lot of push-ups if you're a Michigan fan. 42 of them now as they're piling it on. Michigan State scored a field goal on its first possession of the game. It was a 39-yarder by Dave Rayner. Since then, it has been all maize and blue. You see the guy with the... That's Tony Pape with the mutton chop sideburns there.
Hockey sticks.
His nickname is Fat Elvis.
Well,
as in Elvis in the later years of his life. What do you think?
I'm sure fat isn't an affectionate term.
Of course.
See that guy doing push-ups? He was getting help. He was cheating. Those were cheap push-ups.
Oh, come on, Chris. 42 push-ups, whether you're cheating or not, is tough, man. That's BJ Lovett. Nuh-uh. Down to 10.
He's still a pretty good player.
Georgia unbeaten, but there are still some doubters out there about the Bulldogs. Dowdell continues to quarterback Michigan State. That's DeJuan Moss. Well, that's something we haven't seen much today as he breaks free for a 21-yard gain.
Again, just a credit to Michigan State for hanging in there. DeJuan Moss reflecting his team. So he gets a nice lead block by his fullback. Nobody touches him to the second level. Then arm tackling Mr. Shaw. Come up and put a helmet on him. Don't bump him. You can't bump that big guy.
The longest running play at 21 yards. Only the third play over 20 for Michigan State today. Dowdell rolling, looking, trying to find something, and nothing is going on. Lovett comes in and gets a late block. And that's a flag down on the sidelines as Dowdell goes out of bounds around the 35.
See, that shouldn't be a flag. Why? Because B.J. Lovett, he threw the block before the whistle. B.J. Lovett could not tell where Damon Dowdell. He's trying to protect his quarterback. Right. See, if you're Bobby there, now you don't get mad at that one. That's a guy playing hard. Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Did the right thing, huh?
Yes, he did. You see it right here. Damon Dowdell scrambling for his life. Here comes B.J. That guy's running to him. See, they could have threw a flag outside, but he held up too. And I thought it would have been on B.J. level, but they waved both of them off. Good call. Good no call.
Link Kashima was chasing Dowdell out of bounds, so Lovett is not penalized. They pick up the flag. It's second and nine. Little play action. Dowdell over the middle and pops it again to Jason Randall. He's done that.
Michigan's defense was ranked at the bottom of the Big Ten in third down defense.
Dead last in third down conversions, and they're going to get deeper into last after this. Hey, Rogers with the catch. There's a first down on a third down conversion. Only the third catch for Charles Rogers.
That time Damon threw the ball. See, he's inconsistent. And one time he once hops it, another time he throws a strike. That time Charles Rogers does a good job using his body to shield the defender, catch the football, protect the football, making sure that he has two hands on it.
Dowdell, Chris, just 13 of 29 for 141 yards this afternoon. And you're right, he has been inconsistent. We have seen him throw a couple of one hoppers, particularly to Randall.
Yeah, Randall's been open quite a bit down the seam.
So on first down, Dowdell goes up to Knott, the best pass catching tight end that Michigan State has. And he has stopped short of the 50. Let's take it back down to Rob Stone.
Bam, John Navarre now working the headset. Read the nonverbals. He's done. Spencer Britton just spent a couple minutes warming up behind the bench, so it looks like we're going to have a quarterback change, mercifully, for the Spartans today.
John Navarre, that's a good. You know, we talked about earlier in the year about good baseball head and bad baseball head. That's good headsets.
Right.
When you're have 16 for 27, 229, and three touchdowns, you have the headsets on. That's usually a good sign if you're the starting quarterback.
Terrific day for Navarre, who came in completing 54% of his passes on the season. Up in that, second and seven, Moss. Nice cut back inside, and he picks up another. Spartans first down. That's an 11-yard gain for the senior from Detroit.
Yeah, and then, you know, the Michigan State offensive line playing with a lot of new bodies in there is doing a good job. They're not quitting. The Spartan team's not going to quit. DeJuan Moss running hard. Charles Rogers making catches. They're not going to quit on you.
Still, it will be interesting as you take a look at the rushing yards. Michigan coming into this game averaging only 131 yards on the ground and upwards of, help me out here, Chris, well over 175 yards.
That'd
on
be
the
179,
ground. Thanks,
Pam.
Bud. 179.
That's an Ohio State education coming out.
That was impressive. Charles Rogers can't stretch out to get that one. So 179 yards rushing today for this Michigan offense. They average 131, so they'll be happy with that. Rogers will not be happy. Charles Rogers, he has three catches for 40 yards. His season low came against Northwestern, of all teams, when he had three catches for 53 yards. So he's below that today.
And he was on a lot of the team's Heisman, a lot of people's Heisman list, mine included.
Because in a year when there really is no clear-cut front runner. Dowdell looking for Rogers. Does he get catch number four? Oh, yeah. Good play by Rogers, catching it in front of John Shaw.
Now, see, John Shaw is throwing a fist because he couldn't make up his mind. Either go for the KO or go for the ball. Don't go for KO ball. Go for one or the other. Because I'll tell you what, he had a chance to knock out
Charles Rogers. But if you're going to go up and try to get the interception, see, go up at the highest point. See, John Shaw tried to body catch that. Then if you don't go for the interception, go for the KO. He didn't go for either.
Rogers showing that talent, keeping the feet going. That's a 35-yard gain. First and goal now from the 8. Richard. Flag's coming down as David Richard gets it down close to the 5-yard line.
They got a nice holding call again. Penalties in the red zone just kill Michigan State, not only this game, but the whole year. William Whitaker in the hole.
They will push Michigan.
Michigan's a great school. A great, great tradition, great program.
Hurt to say that? Or?
No.
I know you considered coming here. A lot of people probably don't know that. Tipped and incomplete. Falls harmlessly to the ground. Wow, what a comeback there by Ole Miss. That last play, Pierre Woods, a freshman from Cleveland, Ohio, coming up and making the tip.
Going back to that Auburn-Ole Miss, anytime you have a quarterback, you're in a game. You're in a game in college football.
Eli Manning certainly is a quarterback. Damon Dowdell, the quarterback for Michigan State, takes the timeout. Bobby Williams' crew talks it down. They're down a lot, 42-3. Chris Perry has 49 yards rushing today and starting to talk on the sidelines as this game winds down with Michigan up 42-3. And coming up immediately following this telecast, we'll take you back to Matt Weiner and Mark May for College Game Day Now, presented by Acura. They will get you up to date, give you scores, highlights, and analysis. Some really exciting games going on all across the country today. Second and goal after the timeout. Oh, that is incomplete. Zeal Kavanaugh was in the vicinity, but there are a lot of blue shirts back there as well. We are in Ann Arbor, Michigan, home of the University of Michigan. Pam Ward, Chris Spielman, and Rob Stone along with you, and there are over 111,000 people who came through the turnstiles. 111,542 folks, third largest ever at Michigan Stadium. Biggest crowd for a team other than Ohio State visiting. Total yards, Michigan in control, really, since about midway through the first quarter. Third and goal from the 18. Pushed back because of the holding penalty, and now pushed down as Patrick Massey puts an exclamation point on this game with that sack. Massey from Brecksville, Ohio, outside of Cleveland.
Yeah, Patrick Massey does a good job of getting off on the football. You see it right here, number 94. The good thing when you're in there is you get a good get off right there. He avoided the chop block and finishes the play. Now what you like to see, and once Patrick gets used to getting to that quarterback a little bit more, he'll use one arm now to come and swat the ball out. That time he secured the sack because he was happy he got back there. Next time he'll understand, look, I can tackle this guy because he's got a bum ankle. I'll grab him with one and try to strip with the other.
Be doubly dangerous. That's his second sack of this season and his career. His first career tackle actually was a sack against Western Michigan. So now on fourth down, Dowdell trying to make something happen. And how about back-to-back sacks? That time it's Alain Kashima.
And Kashima does a good job of pursuing to the football, not giving up. Good pressure by the defensive line, forcing Damon Dowdell to run around. Kashima comes from his defensive end positions and finishes the play. Good job of coverage downfield. Damon's looking for Charles Rogers the whole way. He's not there. His eyes leave the downfield receivers. He doesn't see. And right there is the finish by Kashima. Nice job. See, his eyes leave downfield. When your eyes leave downfield, you have no chance.
Good closing in there by Kashima, who is from Montreal in Quebec.
Good point about closing. You know, defensive end, you got to have closing speed to chase those speedy quarterbacks around. That time he showed great closing speed.
And we have a new quarterback, just as we suspected, with Rob Stone giving us the report on the bar with the headphones on. That means it's Spencer Brinton time. He is a junior from California coming in. You see his numbers on the season. Spencer last week, 3 for 6, 37 yards, mop-up duty against Iowa. This is the 7th game in which he has seen some action this year.
Left-hander, number 7, not unusual. Boomer Esiason seem to make that famous.
Scott McBride at Maryland.
Yeah, Scott McBride's a left-hander, number 7.
Yep. Playing North Carolina today, Texas. Tim Brackett now, his first carry, the sophomore from Louisiana. Tell you what, Miami just finding ways to win. Still quite a bit of time left there. Rutgers, what a valiant effort they're doing. As Tyrese Butler can't gather that pass.
We saw Coach Carr down. He's smiling a little bit now. He wasn't smiling yesterday, but this is a big relief because, you know, this was a statement game for Michigan. Iowa openly questioned Michigan's toughness. We asked Jimmy Herman, the defensive coordinator, about that. He said, hey, they're going to believe what they want to believe. But I'll tell you what, under Lloyd Carr's leadership, this team has showed toughness today in how they established a run, and defensively they ran to the football in both ways.
Third and eight. Boy, that schedule, we'll get back to that too. Not easy the rest of the way for these Wolverines. That is a completion. Jermaine Gonzalez, the sophomore from Pontiac, Michigan, gathers it in, a 9-yard gain, first down. So the schedule, Chris, obviously finishing up at Ohio State. That's a tough game next week, isn't it?
Yeah, well, they're going to find out how everybody in the country is going to find out how 19 Minnesota, how good they are. They have 7 wins. A lot of people question their competition. They'll find out how good they are down in Horseshoe. But Minnesota's very good up in the Metrodome in Minneapolis. Wisconsin, always a tough opponent, of course, the game, Ohio State and Michigan.
Finish off the regular season. Just 3 more games, 3 more weeks left in the Big Ten regular season as David Underwood gets that carry. So Charles Rogers, who Lloyd Carr called the best receiver he has ever coached against, the most talented wide receiver, says he has it all, size, speed, everything. And Rogers just sitting there pondering what has become really, Chris, a lost season for this team.
Yeah, it has. And, you know, obviously the smoker suspension is a direct reflect on how Charles plays because he's got to deliver the ball. Damon's still a learning young quarterback who will get better. And, you know, in all fairness to Damon, he's playing basically one leg today with that bum ankle. But Charles, any receiver, their success is obviously directly related to the quarterback's success and getting him the football.
Calvin Bell gets the football there and gets it into Michigan State territory as Rogers, just a junior. Speculation, of course, about what he will do with his future has been swirling for a long time, but one of the more talented receivers to come along in quite a while. And Rogers was one of those guys, as you look at his subpar numbers today, for anybody else would be thrilled with that. Just 4 catches for 75 yards. He's a big Bobby Williams guy.
Yeah.
And when he was coming to Michigan State, that was a major factor that Williams was the head coach.
Well, and make no mistake that with Bobby Williams' situation, how that plays out at the end of the year, certainly probably will have an effect one way or another on what Charles decides to do, whether go pro or stay at Michigan.
They don't seem to miss a beat.
It is scary. It's a credit to recruiting.
And you mentioned that with Minnesota, too, with Terry Jackson stepping in from Barber. And he's awesome. Adam Finley's 5th punt. And that dribbles out of bounds inside the 10-yard line. And we do have a quarterback change. Chris, you're right. Here comes the freshman Aaron Alexander when we return. We are seeing Aaron Alexander at quarterback, the redshirt freshman from Richmond, Virginia, number 10 for Michigan State. He's got 2.5 minutes to show a little something-something. A little rollout, and it's picked off! So Alexander's 4th pass of the season is picked off.
Blake Nassif coming up with the interception, playing from the cornerback position to cover two, kind of baits Aaron Anderson. Showed to cover two. You see him bait. Now he'll fade back to the corner route because Aaron Anderson's not looking off. Goes up to the highest point and makes a nice catch and does a good job of getting down to the sidelines, his closest point to the end zone, and a good job of returning the football.
Good catch. Blake Nassif, the cornerback, a 5th-year senior from Lansing, coming up with his first career interception. He does it as a 5th-year senior at home against Michigan State.
That's special anytime you can do that against your home city to come up with a big play like that. I liked how he came up and caught it at the highest point there. That's good football, and he baited him throwing. He's playing cover two. He melted back into the corner route and made a great catch.
And he's going to remember this moment for the rest
Absolutely.
Of his life, isn't he? That's terrific. Terrific for him. Michigan up 42-3. Brenton, the backup quarterback, he's going to the air. That's a good catch. Coming back to grab it across his body for Michigan. Dayton DeBook. No, that's Stetskall. They're going deep into the. We're going deep now, baby. We're number going, 99.
Yeah, we're going to double numbers now. There's a 99, Pierre Woods, also a number 99. That's a different 99. That's a great catch. Hey, you get your opportunity to make something happen. You know, a little bit surprised, though, that they're throwing the football.
They're giving Britton an opportunity now. And three divisions in the NFL.
Follow this guy. He'll take you to the ball.
Right up the middle is Underwood. As he is last week, the final score against West Virginia, perhaps a bit deceptive because they got a lot of points late. Six more points for Michigan. That's Tim Bracken.
Yeah, you know, again, you might want to say, Lloyd, you want to take a knee, but I think you let your kids play. Give your guys a chance to score. Let them feel the excitement of finishing the game off. Now you got flags in the end zone here. One of the referees might have gotten hit with a marshmallow down there. He didn't like it.
And the crowd, many of whom are still around, from the third largest crowd in Michigan Stadium history, cheering. Personal fouls will offset here. 48-3, 48 unanswered points for the maize and blue. Those guys cold? Just wearing paint to the game, huh?
Yeah.
49 unanswered points for Michigan. Any questions coming into this game, and they've been answered definitively.
Again, now this is just a bad job of filling the gap responsibility right there for Michigan State. Chris Smith did a good job of meeting the block at the point of attack, but he has the B gap. He's got to be on the outside of that block. He would have forced the ball right to Thomas Wright. He got cut up inside. Bracken just hits it and scores.
First career touchdown, too, for Tim Bracken, just a sophomore. As Bracken takes it in, he is from White Castle, Louisiana, and the sideline for Michigan State. Very different looks.
And they need to file this away in their memory bank because they'll play again next year. They'll play again next year. You got to keep it in your mind.
The last time a game was so one-sided between these two teams, Michigan beat Michigan State 42-0 in East Lansing back in 1983. In 1947, the biggest winning series at home since today was 55-0 Michigan. So going all the way back to 1947, this is the worst beating that Michigan State has taken in this stadium.
This is, it's a tough time. It's a tough, no doubt about it, for Coach Williams and his guys. The only thing you can do is rally together. And you win together as a team, you lose together as a team. There's going to be a lot of things said. Just hang together.
College game day now, presented by Acura Follows, as Michigan State will get the football back one last time. We are inside a minute in Ann Arbor. And next week, Michigan State goes on the road to play Indiana. So that's next for them, but they're going to go home. And I'm sure the talk radio shows and the internet chat, you take a look at Indiana, Purdue, and then finishing up at Penn State. Bobby Williams, I mean, some of the stuff that has been said has gone from, I guess, constructive criticism to downright mean.
Yeah, and the thing about, look, you're head coach of the Big Ten. You understand the pressure you're under. He doesn't have a problem with the criticism and the pressure. He can handle it. It's just when, his wife and kids got to handle it, too, and that's where it becomes a little bit tough.
Moss doesn't get much. In fact, that's what he told us. He said he's lucky in a way because he's in meetings all day watching film and practice, but his wife and his children in the community in East Lansing really have to hear all of this, and it's very difficult on them.
You know what? And like I said, being a head coach, you know what you sign on for. You understand the pressure when you coach at a big-time program like Michigan State, Michigan, Ohio State. If you don't win, there's going to be criticism. That's the way it goes. You just hang with yourself, believe in yourself, and rally your troops. He's made tough decisions, too. He's put two guys down. He put Smoker down, and he put Kaplan down. His defensive end.
Trying to keep a hold on this team as Moss gets it again. Charles Rogers only with six touches today, four catches, one rush, and one punt return. John Navarre, three touchdown passes, one rushing touchdown as Michigan defeats Michigan State 49-3 in convincing fashion. Coming up next is College Game Day Now, presented by Acura. For Chris Spielman and Rob Stone, I'm Pam Ward. Thanks for joining us. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com.